conference. Welcome back. And I know that even though the conference room's pretty full, they're still queuing up to get in, including... including when I was in the queue in the shop, someone turned round to me and said, "Oh, I'm a member of the SNP. I didn't know this was on. Can anybody get in?" We can't get everybody in, but we will do our best. Welcome back, delegates. To open this session of conference, we'll go straight to resolutions. Resolution 6 on Trident and austerity. To move the resolution, I call Bill Kidd, MSP, to be seconded by Mike Weir, MP. Welcome, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, convener. Thank you, conference. You know, when they told me I was moving Trident this afternoon, I was... I was up for it anyway, you know. I had my simmet on and everything, you know, but so that'd be fine, but where do you want me to put it? Because, as it happens, of course, there is nowhere else on these islands for the Trident system to be put once we've dismantled it and got it out of Scotland. It'll be an end to Trident in these shores, and that will benefit internationally. It will mean that one of the P5, one of the permanent five on the Security Council of United Nations will not be a nuclear weapons power. Now that... that'll be something for us to be proud of. In December, along with my colleague Angus Robertson, MP, I spoke at the Vienna Conference on the Humanitarian Impact of Nuclear Weapons. There were 158 national governments in attendance, and me and Angus. And out of the 158, only two governments voted against the Austrian pledge to work to end nuclear weapons, the USA and the UK. That made us even more popular because people knew who we were, you know. So across the world, we've got support for our aim to make Scotland nuclear-free. Our campaign on the issue over the years. Our campaign on the issue during the referendum. Our campaign on the issue during these Westminster elections. This is noted and commented on in countries around the world. People know our commitment. People are supportive of our commitment in countries across the world. What they want to see is a nuclear weapons-free zone, Scotland. They want to see Scotland with no nuclear weapons stationed here and no nuclear weapons passing through our ports. That's what people want. That's what we are aiming for. In conference with the return of a greatly increased number of SNP MPs in May, we will make sure that an end to the madness of Trident is up there with an end to the madness of Westminster austerity. Any negotiations we have with Labour are going to be to hold them to stand for an end to austerity and an end to nuclear weapons, because Labour have supported the Tories, their pals, during the referendum. They've supported the Tories in continuing austerity and continuing nuclear weapons. We're going to hold their feet to the fire. They're burning hot, man. Conference, I have four food banks in my constituency of Glasgow Annie'sland. That is an absolute disgrace in the 21st century. Men, women and children, many of them from families who are in work and in work poverty, are reliant on the goodwill and hard work of others to allow them to put food on the table and nappies on babies' bums. It's a disgrace. Jim Murphy and his Labour mob, along with their Tory and Lib Dem mates, have just voted with Osborne's austerity in place and a commitment to £100 billion of scarce resources to Trident replacement. We've got to stop this. Conference, it's about bairns, not bombs. It's about welfare. It's about welfare, not warfare. It's about jobs, not poverty. It's about dignity, not despair. SNP is trusted to serve Scotland. We deserve that trust because we have maintained our pact with the people. Labour threw their pact with the people out a long time ago. It's about time that we ensured an independent, nuclear-free future for all of our people. That's what our party's for. That's what we are going to do. Thank you.
And welcome Mike Weir MP, who's our candidate in Angus.
I forget that one.
To be followed by Graham McCormick.
Well, as I say, follow that. It is an absolute insanity that we are even considering spending £100 billion on new weapons of mass destruction at a time when people in our constituencies, hard-working families, are having to rely on food banks to feed themselves. At a time... at a time when we see government attacking welfare provisions, and as we have seen from the leaks today, they are about to make even bigger attacks on welfare of our disabled people, the most vulnerable in our society. What sort of government puts weapons of mass destruction above people? We campaigned in our referendum. We campaigned in a referendum for bairns, not bombs. That should be how we take this forward. We are fighting for a better Scotland, not a Scotland that hosts nuclear weapons, that is a threat to other nations. And as Bill rightly said, if we are successful in doing this, it will not only remove Trident from Scotland, it will remove Trident from the UK. It will take away nuclear weapons from these islands. When I am in London, I am continually asked by other organisations and other people, will we really do it? Yes, we will. And they support us in doing it. Because there are voices in England, there are voices in Wales that also want rid of Trident. If we have a strong group of SNP MPs in the next Parliament, we can push this issue. We can build support on it. And yes, we can. We can get rid of Trident once and for all. Support this motion.
Now, Graham McCormick, to move the remit back, and I require a seconder for the remit back to be competent. I have a seconder, so Graham will move the remit back. Graham McCormick.
Convener, delegates, I'm conscious that proposers of remit backs are not always as popular as Jerry Fisher, but I feel very strongly about this, and I think you will also. Please read the last sentence of the resolution. It is factually wrong. In a very recent CND poll, 81% of 500 Westminster candidates of different parties oppose Trident replacement, and 75% of Labour candidates polled are against it. So our SNP MPs will not be the only MPs to oppose. We should welcome and acknowledge that because it's a numbers game, even if we win every seat in Scotland, we can't get rid of Trident alone. National Conference is the principal forum for the creation of party policy. You and I should use the powers to declare loud and clear what the SNP's red lines are. A short time ago, this party was not afraid to give its members the opportunity to debate NATO membership, a very challenging subject.
which was conducted in a civil and absorbing way in the full glare of publicity. If we're big enough to debate and decide to be in or out of NATO, why is there no resolution to allow us, the principal policy-making forum, to decide what our red line on replacement of Trident is? When the horse trading starts, is it an absolute or just on issues of defence? We, the 100,000 members, must decide. Last September, the Scots had the opportunity to banish weapons of mass destruction from our nation. Following this general election, our SNP MPs may have the opportunity to banish weapons of mass destruction from a permanent member of the Security Council of the United Nations. Then the United Kingdom will find out what real world leadership is about, and all thanks to this party. But our SNP MPs have to be even stronger, because a strategic defence review is underway, due to report in 2016, which includes the possible reduction of three naval bases, Portsmouth, Plymouth and Faslane, to two. Be in no doubt that the Unionist establishment's quid pro quo for abandoning a seaborne Trident replacement will be the closure of Faslane as a conventional naval base, as Trident is left to wither on the vine and its rusted hulks are consigned to watery graves in the Clyde Sea Lochs and Firth of Forth. Our MPs must not let this happen, not just because of the catastrophic economic and environmental famine which will be visited on the Lower Clyde, but also the loss of Faslane as the future home of the independent Scottish Defence Forces and a publicly owned Clyde Global Port. Remit the motion back and so do it, make it abundantly clear that we expect our SNP MPs to ensure that in any negotiations, the red line is just not no to Trident replacement, but yes to the retention of Faslane as a conventional base. Thank you.
Thank you, Graham. I now call Tasmina Agnes Sheikh, who of course is our candidate for Oco in South Perthshire. Tasmina.
Thank you, Conference. You've heard today, bombs or bairns. The choice is stark, but it's real. Voting for us in May means that you've made the choice and are voting for an end to renewal of Trident. Our First Minister has made it perfectly clear that an SNP group of MPs holding the balance of power would make this an absolute priority. Saving that £100 billion cost for schools, for hospitals, for transport, for combating child poverty, for peacekeeping. How could anyone argue against that? Trident is unusable and an indefensible obscenity. A replacement, even more so. And Conference, let's remind ourselves of the effect of nuclear conflict. Radiation, nuclear winter, enhanced climate change and decimation of food production. This is the cold reality of nuclear war. It is literally unthinkable. And just who are our enemies now that we should reduce their cities to ash? Countries are struggling for economic growth, not global domination. One piece of welcome news, however, is in a new survey of 500 Westminster candidates from above across the political spectrum. 80% say they would vote against the renewal of Trident. Why then? Why do the leadership of both Tories and Labour seem determined to press ahead with this indiscriminate, reckless waste of public money? Whilst almost in the same breath signing up to further £30 billion of cuts. That's further cuts, Conference, forcing more and more families to rely on food banks. Just why are thousands of children in Scotland having to pay the price of irresponsible, successive Tory and Labour governments? Why? And to add insult to injury, we now find ourselves living in a universe where Labour's Ed Ball says there is nothing he would reverse from Tory Osborne's budget. Nothing, Conference. Well, we say enough. With a strong team elected in May, let's stop the waste of billions of pounds on a new generation of weapons. Win the powers we were promised, reverse austerity and invest in jobs. The road to global disarmament is going to be a long and winding one. But unlike Labour, we're committed to getting there. Because only in the warped world of Jim Murphy could you apparently want a world without nuclear weapons whilst voting to spend billions of pounds on them. We, the SNP, will always put humanity above Holocaust and bairns before bombs. And in the words of Mandela, poverty is not an accident. It's man-made and can be removed by the actions of human beings. So on May the 7th, let's elect as many SNP MPs as possible and get to work. Thank you.
Thank you, Tasmina. I won't be able to call any other speakers, but there is the right to sum up. First of all, Graham. Do you waive your right to sum up? You do, thank you very much. Bill Kidd, you have the right to sum up. Okay. Having waived his right to sum up, we'll go straight to the vote for new delegates. Please have your delegate card at the ready. And again, only delegates can vote. If you're just a member visitor, you can't vote. It's delegates only. And what I'll do is I'll call a vote for the remit back, first of all, those in favour, then those against. And then I'll move to the resolution, those in favour and those against. Those in favour of the remit back, please show. Thank you. Cards down. Those against the remit back, please show. Cards down. That was very impressive, I have to tell you, from where I'm sitting in terms of the cards raised. The remit back is defeated. Those in favour of the resolution, please show. Photographers, get a good shot of that. You won't see that at many other party conferences, I tell you. Cards down. Those against the resolution. Okay, it's carried very overwhelmingly. Thank you very much. And now it's my pleasure to introduce to do the financial appeal at conference, Jamie Hepburn MSP. He's the MSP for Cumbernauld and Kilsyth. Please give a very warm welcome to Jamie Hepburn.
Well, thank you very much for that generous introduction, Derek. And yes, conference, it's your favourite part of our proceedings, that part where we fleece you of a little bit more of your cash. Conference is a very great pleasure to see so many old and new faces here today at what is our party's biggest ever conference. It's very nice to see so many people here to see me doing this financial appeal. There's nothing else on the agenda this afternoon, is there? No? The older faces may be somewhat surprised to see me doing this financial appeal. Normally, we're used to seeing our very own party stand-up comedian, Mark MacDonald, MSP, undertaking this task. We're being spared my good friend, Mr. MacDonald's unique take on current events. For those who don't know, Mark recently broke his leg playing football. If you think Mark's funny up on stage, you should see Mark try to play football. And he is unable to be here to attend to his usual task at this conference, unbeknownst to me until about an hour ago. Mark has nominated me in his stead. I must remember to thank him. In preparation for this financial appeal, when I was being told I was doing it, as I say, about an hour ago, Ian McCann, the party clerk, said to me, "You don't have to be funny." I don't know, it was unclear to me whether this was an instruction or, in fact, an expectation, but anyone expecting much by the way of gags about current affairs will be very disappointed, because you see, I don't like political jokes, because I see too many of them on the Labour benches day in and day out in the Scottish Parliament. At conference, we live in the most exciting of times. The referendum campaign, which despite our disappointment. The outcome has unleashed a political reawakening across our country. It has revitalised interest in the civic and political life of Scotland. And of course, our own former First Minister has chronicled his experience of the referendum. I believe sales of his book are going well. I'm sure he'd want me to remind you there's always room for a few more book sales. But I understand, though, that such has been the interest at bookshops and halls across Scotland and indeed beyond, that in fact an unsigned copy of Alex Salmond's book, such as the rarity, is actually worth more than a signed one. That's the kind of joke that will get a guy into trouble, I can tell you that. And of course, we now have a new leader, a new First Minister leading a renewed administration. And as we go into this campaign, we have something that no other party can match, because in Nicola Sturgeon, ladies and gentlemen, we have not only the best political leader in Scotland, but in these whole islands. And since being asked to join her government as Minister for Sport, Health Improvement and Mental Health, Health Improvement, I know the irony is not lost on me either, I can tell you that. I have been very delighted to see ever closer our First Minister's dedication to making Scotland a more thriving and, above all, a fairer country. And the general election in just a few weeks' time, and our campaign to win, is all part of that wave of energy from the referendum. And we know that people across Scotland are responding to that energy very positively. In Cumbernauld, Kilsyth and Kirk and Tulloch East, our candidate Stuart MacDonald is leading an energetic campaign to win on May the 7th. Stuart is just one of 59 outstanding ambassadors for our party at this election. And I can't mention all 59, but as I'm up on this stage, I must mention in passing one other, my old friend Patrick Grady, our National Secretary, who's standing in Glasgow North. And I was very surprised, I'm sure Patrick was, yes, give him a round of applause, there was nearly one, yeah. But I must admit, and hopefully the camera can pick this up, I was very surprised, I'm sure Patrick was even more surprised to see that my old friend Patrick Grady is now caught in badge form. He's on a badge, it says Fantastic Patrick, so, and he looks delighted that I've told you all that, but good luck in Glasgow North, Patrick. Each and every one of those 59 candidates deserves our support through the door knocking and delivering of leaflets that each of you I know are undertaking. But elections also require cash to be won. In this campaign, we're looking to spend £500,000 in support of that election victory we chase. And I should say, we're not expecting anyone in the hall to donate that today, although if someone has it, we will gladly take it. But please give generously as the donation bags are handed around. And remember, we want to hear it crinkle rather than jingle. Everything you donate, it goes towards getting our 59 candidates elected in May. And remember, our candidates stand not to do what our opponents do. They don't stand to go down to Westminster to settle down. They go to settle up for Scotland. They go to oppose Tory and Labour austerity that threatens to push 100,000 more children in Scotland into poverty. They go to stand against the obscenity of Trident on the Clyde. They go to hold the unionists to their commitment to deliver serious powers to our Scottish Parliament. So please give generously and let's work to win on May the 7th. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jamie. Thank you for that. Now we turn to topical resolutions, and topical resolution one on Longannet is to be moved by Mike Weir, MP, and seconded by Douglas Chapman. Welcome back, Mike Weir.
Thank you, Derek. Obviously, when we look at what's happening at Longannet, our first thought must be with the workers and their families and the terrible time that they now face. It's always difficult when something like this happens. Clearly, the Scottish Government is doing all it can to help Long Annet and those who work there. Fergus Ewing, as always, is working round the clock on the issue, both within government, with local authorities, pressing the UK government. But the position at Long Annet also raises serious issues regarding energy in Scotland, because UK policy is partly to blame what has happened here. I have, in my 14 years as an MP, often talked about, even in this conference, about the inequality of transmission charges within an energy system. I've often met with Ofgem, often as well with a certain Alex Salmon some years ago, to push all these issues. He has obviously moved on to greater things since, but I continue to press Ofgem and the UK government, because the transmission charges regime is a relic of a different age. It is an age when there was big energy stations supplying major cities. We've moved on from that. We've often talked about transmission charges in the context of renewables, where they produce extra charges on renewables, and it makes it more difficult for many of our island and remote communities. But now we have seen the full extent of the unfairness of this system with what is happening at Long Annet. Because if you think about it, conference, because of the way this works, Long Annet pays between 40 and 50 million pounds a year to put energy onto the system. Whereas a similar station in the south of England would get a subsidy of up to 15 million pounds for putting that energy on the system. This means that there is a huge disincentive, for energy companies to invest in new generation in Scotland. It has been suggested that when Long Annet goes, that we should put a new gas-fired station there. I tell you, conference, nobody is going to build a gas-fired station there because of the existence of these transmission charges. It would put £50 million on the cost of generating energy there and make it uneconomic to get into the system. We must change this. We must look at it again. We have long argued for a socialisation of transmission charges, the so-called postage stamp system, that would ensure that the cost of generating energy is the same throughout the UK. Because if you think about it, under Ofgem's system, the centres of population, guess where they are? They're London and the southeast of England. Well, I think, look at a map of Scotland. Look at where Long Annet is, and where are the centres of population? Long Annet sits within central Scotland, the main population centres of our nation, and it, if anything, is closer to any centre of population than a station in the south of England. So I have pressed this for many years. Hopefully a much larger group of SNP MPs after the coming election will press this issue with the new government to make sure that we do get a fairer system, that we are able to generate more energy within our country to meet our energy needs and to create work for our people. I'd urge you to support this motion and press for a fair deal for Scotland's energy.
Thank you, Mike. I call Douglas Chapman to second, and Douglas is the parliamentary candidate in Dunfermline and West Fife. Douglas Chapman.
Conference, good afternoon. This motion is all about saving 1,000 Scottish jobs. 6 weeks ago, Fife Council councillors in the SNP group won cross-party support for a motion to save Long Annet because we knew the writing was on the wall. Part of that motion asked Fife Council to seek an urgent meeting with UK ministers. I'm sorry to say that in a report to conference, we found out last week, 5 weeks on, that no request was made by the Labour Control Council in Fife to have that meeting with UK ministers. I can say that maybe after Craig Walker's win in Glenrothes in the last 48 hours, Fife might not be a Labour Control Council for very much longer. The Scottish Parliament Energy Committee, Fife Council asked for a task force to be set up, and that was days before the closure announcement was made last Monday. We don't want a task force to be set up in advance of a closure. That happens afterwards where there's no other option open to us. Our priority was to save the 1,000 jobs at Long Annet. Labour's priority was to throw in the towel on these 1,000 Scottish jobs. I want to thank Fergus Ewing for all his help and his many visits to Long Annet over recent weeks and months, and to John Swinney as well, who visited Long Annet just last Monday. We should, however, remind ourselves that the full responsibility for energy policy lies with the UK ministers in Westminster. UK ministers over this whole debacle have been in hiding. UK ministers have been silent. Where are the broad shoulders of the UK when the workers at Long Annet need them? Well, Long Annet is crucial in maintaining the quality of supply and the security of supply in the medium term for Scotland. We all want to see a greener, cleaner approach to electricity production. But it seems only like yesterday when I was standing here before conference asking why the Tories and the Lib Dems had pulled the plug on £1 billion in carbon capture investment at Long Annet, which would have given the plant a greener, cleaner future and created new jobs in a completely new industry. This is why we need to return as many SNP MPs to Westminster in May. I don't think we'll all troop off the train at King's Cross to the background music of Star Wars Imperial Masters. But we will... That might be nice. But we'll be standing there. We'll be standing up for Scottish jobs and saying, energy policy cobbled together in London, no thanks. Energy regulation devised in London, no thanks. Decisions about Scottish jobs made in London, no thanks. Labour may have given up. The SNP will never throw in the towel on Scottish jobs for our energy industry. Conference with 40 days and 40 nights to win this election. Let's go and do it. Thank you.
There are no cards in against. Can I ask conference, is the resolution passed by acclaim? It is, thank you. And now to topical resolution 2. It will be moved by Grant Toms and seconded by Alison Lewis. Welcome, Grant Toms.
My, this is impressive. It's a long time since my first conference in 1997 at Rothesay Pavilion. Derek was in his nappies at the time, of course, but... It doesn't feel that long ago to me, but what a difference in terms of size and numbers here. This week has been one of the most difficult weeks in my family's life. On Wednesday, the culmination of the Penrose inquiry into contaminated blood reported their findings looking at what had happened to a number of haemophilia sufferers in terms of how they were dealt with by the NHS in the 70s and 80s and how they became infected through contaminated blood products with hepatitis C and in some cases HIV as well. My uncle was one of those 193 who became infected with hep C and unfortunately did not live to see the culmination of that report. He spent most of his working life, when he found out in his late 30s that he'd become infected, eventually, when the NHS at that time, with their culture of practice of trying to be paternalistic, that maybe you shouldn't know about these things because it won't do you any good, had been trying to bring up his family, had been trying to run a business, and you know, through all the struggles of having a haemophilia as a condition in the first place, then, you know, that's quite a struggle in life to get through and do things just like any ordinary person would. When you then get told eventually that you have now taken on another health condition that is even more of a threat to your life than your haemophilia, it turns your world upside down. Not only did you think about how his family might become infected as well and learn all the and understand how to be safe and to ensure that he would not be able to pass on these conditions, he also had to realize that his business, which was in the food industry, could be hugely affected if anybody came out and found out that he had this condition. That's the sort of impact it has on your life, where you're trying to struggle and cope with what has been dealt with you. But he didn't just sit back and accept that. He got involved with other haemophilia sufferers and was instrumental in creating the Scottish Infected Blood Users Forum, who began to campaign along with the Haemophilia Society, as it became Haemophilia Scotland, to seek truth and justice about who knew what and what happened, and how could we learn from the clinical disasters that have taken place at that time in the NHS. Now, we have defended the NHS as much, you know, in this time and climate tremendously, ensuring that it's financially resourced, that it's able to extend its best practice as much as possible. But it has, like any other profession, gone through changes and difficulties, and it's had to learn along the way. This week, the report showed up some of that negativity around learning clinical practice and having to be able to improve on it. But we are going to turn the corner. And it's a no small thanks to Nicola Sturgeon and Shona Robertson, who basically, from the days of opposition, listening to people like my uncle giving evidence to the Scottish Parliament about how they've been impacted and what they needed to change and how they needed an inquiry to find out what the truth was. Shona and Nicola supported that in opposition. One of the first things that Nicola did when she became Health Minister was to institute an inquiry headed by Lord Penrose. And if anyone has got the time to read 1,800 pages of that report and make sense of it and tell me something different, I'll tip my hat to you straight away. It is a huge report. It will take some time to digest its implications, but there are a number of things there that still need to be resolved for haemophilia sufferers who were infected and became HIV and carry Hep C. These are issues that involve financial compensation. It also involves being able to access the drug medication that is now available to treat this and not have it that people wait until they're at the end of a very difficult and more serious condition. They have to be able to get those resources now. I'm not going to say any more than that. It has been a very, very personal week. And I think I'd like conference to show their appreciation to what people like Nicola and Shona have done to help force this issue forward and get us to where we are today and can help the sufferers ensure that we get justice now that we've found out a bit more about the truth. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Grant. And Alison Toulis will second. And Alison's the candidate in the Glasgow Central constituency.
Thank you very much, Derek. I don't want to add a great deal to what Grant Toms has laid out, other than to say that my heart absolutely goes out to everyone that has been affected by this really terrible tragedy. The Scottish Government, as Grant has said, have done their very best within the parameters of the current legislation, and Nicola and Shona have both met with the families and made apologies on their own behalf and on behalf of the Government and previous administrations. I think the most important thing, though, is that there is an awful lot of frustration with the current public inquiries process. People have to wait an awful long time to see justice and to see a resolution and to get to the point where compensation can be got. And the powers under the current Inquiries Act come from Westminster, and those powers don't quite go far enough. I think one of the things that a good team of SNP MPs down at Westminster can do is to push for a change in the Inquiries Act to make things move more swiftly, to make justice come more easily to the people that require it. Because just now, when you see public inquiries, when you take this particular case of the Penrose Inquiry, when you look at people who have waited so long for justice as part of the Hillsborough Inquiry, we need and we must do better. We've got a duty to the people that are affected by these tragedies to find a swifter and better resolution to the process. Support the resolution. Thank you.
There are no cards in against. Can I ask, is the resolution passed by acclaim? It is, and we now turn to our final topical resolution on the Chagos Islands and will be moved by Willie Henderson. It will be formally seconded by Julie Hepburn, so please welcome William Henderson.
Thank you very much, convener. The last time the Chagos Islands featured on our agenda was at Annual Conference 2010 in Perth Concert Hall. We're in a slightly larger venue this time, with a few more members than we had back then, which is rather nice, I must say. What isn't nice, and in fact is utterly outrageous and scandalous, is what's happened to the people of the Chagos Islands for decades and continues to happen today at the hands of British and American governments. Our previous resolution from 2010 was entitled Diego Garcia, after the main island in the Chagos simply recognised the fundamental right to self-determination of peoples under the Charter of the United Nations and gave our support to the Chagossians. In December 2010, Mauritius lodged an arbitration claim against the United Kingdom over the creation of a marine protected area that same year around the Chagos. When Mauritius became independent from the UK in the 1960s, Westminster decided to keep some islands in the Indian Ocean. They separated the Chagos Islands from Mauritius and kept them as London's own sovereign territory. The story sounds somewhat familiar, I think, to us today. The tribunal unanimously found in favour of Mauritius on the 18th of March this year. The Chagos Marine Protected Area, established by the United Kingdom government in 2010, was a sham then, it is a sham now, and the entire world can see it. Why create such a marine protected area? Well, in 2010, WikiLeaks published a confidential memo from the US Embassy in London, noting discussions from the previous year between US and UK officials. That embassy memo stated, establishing a marine reserve might, indeed, as the FCO stated, be the most effective long-term way to prevent any of the Chagos Islands' former inhabitants or their descendants from resettling in that territory. The marine protected area was not about protecting flora and fauna in these beautiful islands. It was about creating a mechanism to prevent the people who have a right to live on those islands from returning to their homes. 50 years ago, the UK ratified a treaty with the US to create a military base on that main island of Diego Garcia. As part of that grubby, shabby deal, the people who lived on those islands were removed from their ancestral homes before being forced to live and in many cases die overseas. In one 1966 memo, a Foreign Office official stated, "We must surely be very tough about this. The object of the exercise was to get some rocks, which will remain ours. There will be no indigenous population except seagulls, who have not yet got a committee in the United Nations." In a handwritten note on the foot of that memo, one Foreign Office official in Whitehall wrote, "Unfortunately, along with the seagulls go some few Tarzans and Man Fridays that are hopefully being wished on Mauritius." That is documented in one of many formerly confidential memos about this shameful episode in British history. One of the Chagossians expelled from his home was Olivier Bancoult. He was an infant when he was forced to leave his islands. He now lives in Mauritius and leads the Chagos refugee group, and he's battled the UK government in the courts for many years. Here's what he had to say a decade ago about the Chagos Islands in his own words. "Everyone had a job and life was wonderful then. Our nightmare began when the UK decided to lease our motherland to the US to build a military base. The UK government removed all Chagossians from their birthplace and dumped them in Mauritius and the Seychelles with no planning for them." He made a plea, and in conclusion he said, "We make an appeal to every country who believes in human rights and justice to give us their support to fight against neo-colonialism. The resolution asks those of us here today some simple questions. Do we stand shoulder to shoulder with the Chagossians and support the right to return home? Will we stand up for human rights and justice? Will we answer the appeal from the downtrodden and dispossessed? Our reply has to be loud and clear. Yes, support the resolution."
Thanks, Willie. There are no cards and against as the resolution passed by acclaim. It is, thank you very much. And shortly we'll come to the address by our party leader, Nicola Sturgeon. But before that, who would like to see the new party broadcast? No, you're going to have to do better than that. Who would really like to see the new party broadcast? Yeah. Aye, all right then. The new broadcast.
This is our place, our country. I don't think we're better than any other country, but I think we're every bit as good. And I know we're capable of doing more given half a chance. Sure, it can be a wee bit rough around the edges sometimes. And it's fair to say we like having a laugh, but that doesn't mean to say we don't care. We care passionately. I know we can be an argumentative bunch. That's not necessarily a bad thing, especially if it gets stuff done. Proud, optimistic, full of hope, and gallus as hell on occasion. No apologies, that's just who we are. I know where I'm from. What I'm asking is, where are we going? Last year was a roller coaster. Everyone wants change now. And there's an election coming up. I remember when Labour used to stand up to the Tories. That's just not happening anymore. It's time for new ideas. Something positive. Something different from cuts, cuts, cuts. So who's going to shout no way, enough to unfair policies? Who's going to look out for our kids, for our jobs, for our NHS? And who's going to keep Westminster to its promise of more power for Scotland? The question for us here in Scotland isn't which Westminster party will become the next UK government. The question is, who's really going to stand up for Scotland? Well,
I have to say, I did rather like that. We may be seeing more of it. Friends, it's the highlight of conference, any conference, and I've got to introduce somebody. Do I introduce the leader of the Scottish National Party? Not enough. Do I introduce Scotland's First Minister? Not powerful enough. Do I introduce the leader of the UK's third largest party? Not big enough yet. I want to introduce to you the only party leader in the UK who people actually like. Let me just say that again. The only party leader with positive approval ratings throughout the UK. This is something our opponents can only imagine. And then I thought, wait a minute, Ed Miliband, imagine. No, that's not right at all. Ladies and gentlemen, the leader of the SNP, Scotland's First Minister, or as we like to call her, Nicola Sturgeon.
What a sight. Friends, let me begin today by congratulating three people who yesterday showed the strength and depth of SNP support across the country, three people who got our conference off to a flying start, our trio of by-election winners. What a hat-trick. So, to Councillor Sonia Warren from Buckie, Councillor Sarah King from Armadale, and Councillor Craig Walker from Glenrothes, we say thank you, well done, stand up and take a bow. Conference, we meet here today in this great city of Glasgow. It's highly appropriate that we do so, and for many different reasons. First, and not least, there's the fact that I live here. And surely one of the perks of leadership must be that I can get you to come to me. Then, of course, there's the fact that this city, Scotland's biggest city, voted yes. Where better to recommit our party and our movement to the values that define us, the values that have excited the imagination of so many across our country, the values of fairness, prosperity, and opportunity for all, the restless desire to make Scotland the nation we know it can be, a prosperous country where everyone gets the chance to fulfill their potential, a fair society where no one gets left behind, a confident nation working with our friends and family across these islands, an independent country equal to the very best. Friends, that vision lit up this nation last year. Let us rededicate ourselves to it here today in the wonderful Yes City of Glasgow. Of course, there is one other reason that we meet here in Glasgow, a rather more practical reason. This city is now one of the very few places in Scotland with venues big enough to accommodate all of our new members. Delegates, last year we set ourselves the ambitious target of reaching 100,000 members by the general election. Well, with 40 days to go, I can tell you that we've not just reached that target, we have surpassed that target. I can tell you today that membership of the Scottish National Party now stands at 102,143. Friends, these are indeed special times for our party. But that is only because these are special times for our country. 6 months ago, people across this nation, yes voters and no voters, discovered what it felt like to be in charge, to hold the future of our country in our hands. We didn't choose independence this time. But make no mistake, September 18, 2014 was a moment of liberation for this nation of ours. It was the moment when this simple truth became clear to all of us. We need not be powerless in the face of remote Westminster decisions. We can make Westminster sit up and take notice, and friends, that is exactly what we intend to do. And let us understand this. Our voice as a country will be louder if it is united. That's why my message today reaches far beyond the ranks of our party. It goes to every home, community and workplace across our land, to yes voters and to no voters, to those who have always voted SNP in Westminster elections and to those who have never ever done so before. On May the 7th, let us put the normal divisions of politics to one side. Let us come together on that day as one country. Let us seize this historic moment to shift the balance of power from the corridors of Westminster to the streets and communities of Scotland. Let us this time vote SNP and make this nation's voice heard like never before. And being no doubt the only way for Scotland to shake up the Westminster establishment is to vote SNP. The Westminster parties won't do it. They are the establishment. Just look at their reaction to the polls. You know, just a few short months ago, we had Labour, Tory and Lib Dem politicians falling over themselves to tell us that our voice really mattered, that Scotland was a valued member of the family of nations. Remember the slogan? Scotland shouldn't leave the UK, we should lead the UK. But now, when it looks as if the people of Scotland might actually take them at their word, and vote for a party that will make Scotland's voice heard, these same politicians throw their hands up in horror. How dare we seek to influence the Westminster system they begged us to stay part of? Well, friends, I don't know about you, but I think any democratic, progressive party that frightens the life out of the Westminster establishment is good news for ordinary people in Scotland and across these islands. Because here's the thing, when these politicians outrageously describe the prospect of the SNP winning a general election in Scotland as some kind of threat to democracy, what they mean is that we pose a threat to their vested interests. We pose a threat to the notion of democracy that has them turn up for election once every 5 years and take Scotland for granted the rest of the time. We challenge a parliamentary system that has more members in the unelected House of Lords than in the elected House of Commons. What a democratic outrage that is. And we rail against a cosy consensus that hits the poor with the bedroom tax and benefit sanctions while turning a blind eye to the tax avoidance of the super rich. So yes, David Cameron, Ed Miliband and Nick Clegg, if you're worried that a strong SNP is a threat to all that is deeply undemocratic and unfair about the Westminster notion of democracy, then all I can say to you is this: you had better believe we are. But friends, to ordinary people across these islands who feel just as let down by that out-of-touch Westminster system as we do, I have a very different message. It is a message of friendship and solidarity. I won't pretend that the SNP doesn't still want Scotland to be independent. I think I can safely say we do still want Scotland to be independent. But at this general election, with the power of the big parties weaker than ever before, I say this to people of progressive opinion all across the UK. As long as Scotland remain part of the Westminster system, we will be your allies in seeking to shake up and reform that outdated and discredited system once and for all. Westminster needs to change to be more responsive to the needs and demands of ordinary people wherever they are in the UK. So to people in England, Wales and Northern Ireland, I make this promise. The SNP stands ready to work with you in making that positive change for all of us. And we bring to that task vast experience of government, of successful, effective and stable government. It was as a minority government that we restored free education, abolished prescription charges and froze the council tax. So we can and we will use that experience in a minority-led House of Commons to get good things done there too. We will. We will demand an alternative to slash and burn austerity. Responsible deficit reduction, yes, but cuts that tear at the very fabric of our society, penalise the poor, threaten our public services and stifle economic growth. Let me make it crystal clear, those will not be in our name. We will demand an NHS in public hands, a fair wage for all, pensions that protect our older people, and a decent welfare system that helps people into work. And let me also promise this. At a time when in-work poverty is on the rise and people are being forced to use food banks, when public services are under strain and conventional defence forces are being cut to the bone, we will stand firm and unwavering against a single brass penny, let alone £100 billion being spent on the obscene status symbol that is a new generation of Trident nuclear weapons. Delegates, ours will also be a voice for democratic reform. We'll push for a fair voting system to be back on the agenda. And as Labour, the Tories and the Lib Dems prepare for another 5 years of empty rhetoric, on reform of the House of Lords, we will take a much more straightforward view. The House of Lords has no place in a democratic society. Delegates, the House of Lords, which, remember, was voted for by no one, recently tried to stop 16 and 17-year-olds getting the vote in Scotland. Its members are paid £300 a day for just showing up, and it's totally tax-free. That's got to stop. Friends, people with no democratic mandate should not be writing the laws of the land. It is now time to abolish the House of Lords. Conference, a strong, powerful SNP team standing up for Scotland and working for progressive change across these islands. That is the prize that now lies within our grasp. But listen, when I say this, it will not fall into our laps. Now, I can't deny that recent opinion polls have made for pleasant reading. In fact, I think one or two of them might have given me altitude sickness. But friends, we know from long and sometimes bitter experience that polls don't win elections. Good ideas and hard work win elections. So we will take nothing for granted. We must work harder over these next 40 days than we have ever done before. No let up. No resting on our laurels, no slowing down to savour the opinion polls. Let me make this clear. Hard graft, humility, and a daily determination to earn the trust of the people of Scotland, these will be the hallmarks of our campaign. Because no matter what the polls say, we do have a mountain to climb. We have six MPs. In most of the other 53 seats in Scotland, we face hefty majorities. The biggest number of MPs we have ever had at Westminster is 11. So the next time you read the polls, remember this. Any seat we manage to win beyond 11 will be record-breaking for the SNP. But just as we will take nothing for granted, nor will we set any limit on our ambition. The more seats we win for the SNP, the louder Scotland's voice is going to be. It is that simple. So my message to all of you is this. No constituency in Scotland is off limits for the SNP in this election. We will fight for every vote and for every seat. Let's get out there and turn these poll predictions into reality. Let's win this election, not for the SNP, but for Scotland. Of course, the Westminster parties will pull out all the stops to halt the SNP surge. We saw in the referendum that there is no fear and no smear that they won't stoop to. Mind you, their tactics so far in this election seem more comical than scary. Just listening to them in their blind panic can really make you dizzy. The Tories say that if you vote SNP, you get Labour, and Labour says that if you vote SNP, you'll get the Tories. They can't both be right. But friends, they are both wrong. So, for the avoidance of doubt, let me spell out exactly what will happen in the election. If you vote SNP on May the 7th, what you will get is the SNP, no one else, just the SNP, the only party that stands up for Scotland first, last and always. You won't be letting the Tories in the front door. Let me say it loud and let me make it clear. The SNP will never put the Tories into government, not now, not ever. And you won't be letting the Tories in the back door either. You see, as long as there are more anti-Tory MPs, Labour or SNP, than there are Tory MPs in the House of Commons, we can keep them out of government. Now, I know Labour can't admit this. After all, they vote Labour to keep out the Tories' line, however detached from reality it might be, is the last remaining plank of their desperate and failing campaign. But it is nevertheless a matter of simple arithmetic. If there are more anti-Tory than Tory MPs after the election, the only way the Tories get back into power is if Labour lets them back into power. So, in the interests of total clarity, let me make this promise today. If there's a hung parliament, SNP MPs will vote to stop a Tory government even getting off the ground. I call on Labour today to match that pledge, to make clear that if Labour and the SNP combined have more seats than the Tories, they will join forces with us in a vote of confidence to lock David Cameron out of Downing Street. And if Labour fails to make that commitment today, the only conclusion people will draw is that Labour would rather have the Tories back in power than work with the SNP. And that will be the final nail in the political coffin of Scottish Labour. It really will be time to lock the doors of the branch office once and for all. Friends, a vote for the SNP is a vote to keep the Tories out. But it's much more than that. It's also a vote to make sure that the Tories are replaced with a better alternative. We know from long experience that a Labour government left to its own devices simply can't be trusted to deliver the change that Scotland needs and wants, and that is a fact. The last Labour government was elected on a wave of hope and optimism, but it ended up imposing tuition fees, privatising the NHS, presiding over a growing gap between rich and poor, and taking us into an illegal war in Iraq. So the message couldn't be clearer. If you want a Labour government to have backbone and guts, you need to elect SNP MPs to provide it for them. If you want the vow of more power for our Parliament to be delivered in full, then you need SNP MPs to go to Westminster to redeem that promise. And if you want a Labour government that won't just be a carbon copy of the Tories, but will instead deliver the real change that Scotland needs, then you must elect SNP MPs to force Labour's hands and keep them honest. One of the most urgent reasons to vote SNP in this election is the threat of even deeper austerity. The contrast between the SNP and the Westminster parties couldn't be more stark. Last week, George Osborne's budget laid bare the deep cuts planned for the next Parliament, £12 billion for Scotland alone. We've set out a clear alternative to that. Modest real-term spending increases in each year of the next Parliament instead of cuts would see the deficit and debt fall as a share of national income. It is fiscally responsible. But it would also free up billions of pounds to invest in infrastructure and skills, public services and protecting the vulnerable. Labour has set its face against it. But just last week, the Institute for Fiscal Studies said that they could adopt our policy and still meet their fiscal targets. So I challenge Labour today to join us in opposing austerity, not in words, but in their spending plans. And if they won't, I serve notice now here today that we will use our influence in the House of Commons to force them to abandon the needless pain of Tory cuts. Friends, we will use our clout in other ways to make life better for people across our country. Fair work is at the very heart of our government's agenda. We will take whatever action we can to eradicate working practices that have no place in a decent modern economy. And top of that list will be the zero-hours contracts that demean and exploit people across our country. The basic principle of a fair day's pay for a fair day's work is also fundamental to our sense of society. But in Scotland today, nearly half of all adults and more than half of all children who live in poverty are in households where at least one person is working. You know, one of the ambitions I set for my first year as First Minister was to get at least 150 companies signed up as living wage employers. I'm proud to tell you that after just 4 months, and thanks to the enthusiasm of Scotland's employers and the hard work of the Poverty Alliance, we have already delivered that target. So today, I can announce that we will go further. Today, I'm setting a new target. Within the next 12 months, we aim to have not 150, but 500 companies signed up and paying the living wage to all of their workers. Conference, I am determined that we will make Scotland a living wage nation. Of course, we could do more to lift people out of poverty if Labour and the Tories hadn't combined to stop powers over the minimum wage and key decisions on welfare being devolved to our Parliament. But with a powerful team of SNP MPs, we can demand that these powers do come to Scotland. And in the meantime, we can vote for them to be used in a way that will lift people out of poverty. Delegates, I can announce today that in the next Westminster Parliament, the SNP will back an increase in the minimum wage of £2 an hour, taking it to £8.70 by 2020. Friends, securing fair work is just one part of making Scotland a fairer, more equal society. A good standard of living depends not just on being paid a decent wage, but also on having access to good quality public services, free at the point of need and accessible to all. There is no service closer to our hearts than the National Health Service. I am proud of our Scottish NHS. The staff who work in our hospitals, communities and health centres do an amazing job, and they do it in often very difficult circumstances. Today, on behalf of all of us, I thank them from the bottom of my heart for all that they do. But more importantly, I promise that my government, for as long as we are in office, will continue to protect the budget of the National Health Service. Friends, earlier this week, David Cameron was booed when he was asked about the NHS. And no wonder. Before the last election, he ruled out top-down reorganisation of the NHS in England, but as soon as he was in office, he broke that promise. He claims repeatedly that the Tories have no plans to extend privatisation, but he's legislated to allow the private sector to use up to 49% of hospital beds in England. And he says that TTIP, the proposed new trade treaty between the US and the EU, poses no threat to our health service, but he refuses to put that beyond doubt. Well, let me make our position on that very clear. No ifs, no buts. There must be an explicit protection for the NHS on the face of the TTIP agreement. Friends, make no mistake, the continued privatisation of the NHS in England threatens the budget of the Scottish Government. So I give this commitment today. SNP MPs, in order to protect Scotland's budget, will vote at Westminster to halt the tide of NHS privatisation in England. We will use our voices and our votes to keep the NHS north and south of the border firmly in public hands. And just as good quality healthcare is essential to a decent society, so too is education. The truth is, without the free education that I was so lucky to have, I wouldn't be standing here as First Minister today. For me, keeping education free is personal. And I give you this absolute guarantee. As long as I am your First Minister, there will be no tuition fees in Scotland. I want to do more than just keep education free. I want to make sure that many more young people from ordinary and disadvantaged backgrounds get the opportunity to take advantage of free education. That's why I've set up a £100 million Scottish attainment fund. I want to make sure that a child born today in one of our most deprived communities, by the time he or she leaves school, has the same chance of going to university as a child from a wealthier background. So today I'm announcing further support to help young people stay in education. When the Tories abolished the educational maintenance allowance in England, we retained it in Scotland. That allowance provides £30 a week to pupils from the least well-off families. And for many of these young people, it makes the vital difference between them being able to continue in education and being forced to leave to find employment. Currently, educational maintenance allowances help 35,000 young people in Scotland stay in education. Today, I can confirm that the Scottish Government will extend that scheme so that it benefits even more of our young people. Firstly, we will raise the eligibility threshold to make payments available to an additional 10,000 school pupils. And second, we will extend the scheme to part-time college students, helping another 12,000 young people stay on in education. That means from next year, a total of 57,000 16 to 19-year-olds will be entitled to receive an educational maintenance allowance. Friends, that is real help for the young people who need it most to stay on in education and fulfil their potential. Delegates, education is my personal passion. And securing the best possible opportunities for all of our young people will drive the decisions I make as First Minister. It's also what drives my ambitions for young women. As the first woman to hold the office of First Minister, I am determined that unlike that other woman leader we once knew, I will use my time in this job to improve the lives of women across our country. For me, that means challenging discrimination and championing women's achievements. It also means leading by example. You know, I despair that today in 2015, there are only 3 gender-balanced cabinets in the whole of the developed world. But I am really, really proud that mine is one of them. There are many things, too many things, that still stand in the way of gender equality. Systemic and institutional barriers that we need to remove. The pay gap, occupational segregation, a lack of affordable childcare, and sometimes just outdated attitudes. But for too many women, it's the violence and the abuse they suffer in their own homes. Domestic abuse is a crime that affects 1 in 6 women in our country. Earlier this week, in a speech to Scottish Women's Aid, I announced plans to strengthen the law on domestic abuse. Subject to consultation, we will introduce legislation this year. But changing the law is not enough. We need to do more. That is why I am announcing today new funding of £20 million over the next 3 years to step up our work to tackle violence against women. We will invest that money to speed up the court process, give more support to victims, and expand schemes to help offenders change their behaviour. Delegates, addressing the scourge of domestic violence is essential if we are ever to achieve true gender equality in this country. And let me make it clear, I am determined to lead a government that will do just that. Friends, I began this speech by reflecting on the aspirations that shone through the referendum campaign, on our shared ambition to become a fairer society, a more confident nation, and a more prosperous country. Those objectives continue to light up our political discourse in Scotland. They are the aims that each and every day will guide our actions as your government. And they are the aims that, with the support of the Scottish people, we will carry to the very heart of Westminster. To the people of Scotland, I make this promise. SNP MPs will not go to Westminster to settle down. SNP MPs will go to Westminster for one reason and one reason only: to do a good job for you and to win a better deal for Scotland. We will work every single day to protect Scotland's interests and to make your voice heard. We will seek to use whatever influence you give us to call a halt to ever deeper austerity, to protect our NHS, and to say loudly and clearly that the precious resources of our country should be invested in the future of our children, not in nuclear bombs. We will use our influence to win for our Scottish Parliament the full financial and social powers that it needs to grow our economy and create more jobs. And we will work in a spirit of friendship and cooperation with others who share our ideals. We will work with everyone, wherever they may be in the UK, who wants to see greater fairness and prosperity at the heart of their communities too. You know, over the next few weeks, there will continue to be talk of the deals that might be done after this election. But from now until May the 7th, there is only one deal I am interested in. There is only one deal this party will seek to do, and that is with you, the people of Scotland. If you place your trust in us to be your advocates at Westminster, we will fight Scotland's corner with passion, principle and conviction. We will stand up for Scotland's interests without fear or favour. We will represent you to the best of our abilities, no matter your politics, your point of view and regardless of how you voted in the referendum last year. That is the deal we offer. It is what you will get if you vote SNP. It is my pledge and my guarantee to each and every one of you. So today, with humility, but also with determination, I ask for your support on May the 7th so that together we can make Scotland's voice heard. Thank you very much.
Thank you, conference. We are not quite done, so if you're making your way out, can you please do so quietly? Through the official doors, not through the magic curtain. And shortly we'll be returning to the resolutions. The next resolution is on the home care sector. If you're staying, please take your seats. Where does it say second? Where's the second? Sorry? Well, I don't know. Let's see.
Yeah, they're right. I couldn't see a second. It's like some. So, you've got. I don't know if to move. Unless the park just came in. Well, that looks like it's for Amendment 1.
Amendment? That's the amendment?
Yeah.
That's the amendment?
Yeah.
That's the second amendment. Okay, delegates, let's continue with conference. Shh. Silence, please. And to follow that, I call Carol Ralph to move the resolution to be seconded by David Howie. Carol Ralph.
How on earth do you follow that? Whilst 3,000 or so of us have been here today, delegates, tens of thousands of home carers are getting up, armies of home carers across Scotland from the wee small hours of the morning, and they're going about their business quietly, compassionately, efficiently, and with love. They do the most personal of jobs, feeding, washing, and changing the people we love and care about, and it allows people to get out of hospital and back to their own homes. Their work and dedication enables our NHS to cope with a population living longer and putting strains on budgets. 80% of those carers are women. They often work for the minimum wage with little training or supervision, available for 16 hours a day and yet maybe only being paid for two or three of these hours as they go in at breakfast time, at lunchtime, at tea time, at bedtime. Can you imagine working for 3 hours pay and yet being available for 16 hours a day? Many get no overtime. They're not paid for unsociable hours. And then there is the utter scandal and abuse of 0 hours contracts. I spoke with one carer recently who had not had a day off for 7 weeks. 7 weeks, she was frightened not to accept the hours she was offered in case she lost her job. Many complain of rushed visits, too close together, of not being asked to do extra shifts. Delegates, for far too long now, we have taken the work of this vital service for granted, and it's high time that we recognise the contribution of what has become the Cinderella service. Last year, an old friend who should have been here today was stuck in hospital for 10 weeks because the area she lived in couldn't provide home care. It's not good for an older person, and delayed discharges and a wasted use of resources. So why couldn't she get a carer? Because good carers are leaving the sector every day. They're exhausted by the demands of the job, the low wages, and the exploitation of their goodwill. They've been taken for granted for far too long. Morale is at an all-time low, and we need to act now to ensure that the service gets the support that it deserves. We must recognise and reward all these valuable, hard-working professionals in the same way as we do our NHS nurses and doctors. The delivery of a caring and compassionate service must be a priority. As a society, we are judged by the way we look after our most vulnerable citizens. I am hugely proud of our party and of our SNP government for their continued commitment to free personal care for people over the age of 65. Money and profit cannot and should not be the driving factor of a social care sector. And friends, we should never forget that if we're lucky, we will all be old one day and we might not all need that care someday. The contrast in how we look after our ageing population is stark when we look over the border. And the ticking time bomb that is our ageing population is not confined to us in Scotland. Yet this Tory government have cut their spend in social care in England by 12%. Unbelievable. In 4 years, adult spending has reduced, yet the number of people needing care has risen by 14%. The needs of care rises, yet spending falls. Yes, but there is always money for nuclear arms and for the House of Lords. It is not right. Conference, social care is not an additional extra, and if Westminster does not see this and invest in it now, then there will be no hope for the NHS south of the border, and they're even more stupid than I ever thought possible. Finally, I ask you to support the resolution. Let us today stand up for each and every home carer in this land and commit to ensuring we will do all within our power to protect, enhance and recognise their vital role in the future of our Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. And David Howe to second, to be followed by Mary Black, who will move the amendment. No, David Howe first. David Howe first. Mary. Yeah. You've come and sit here. You've come too soon. It's fine. It's David Howe to second. No, you follow. It's fine. I get the seconder to the resolution first. David Howe.
David.
Anybody at all can speak. Welcome, David.
Take a bow then, Mama. Forget that, right? Conference. Put glasses on so you can see me. I will see you, sorry. Who enjoyed this speech? Good, because I can't follow it. Conference. I have to admit, my first thought was actually to be Mr. Back. Unfortunately, due to what happened the last time I tried that, it didn't work, and as you showed, it didn't work either. Conference, I'm a member of the People Powered Health and Wellbeing at the Alliance Scotland. Housing is not my strong point, I was about that. It did, however, come from a fringe event which the Health and People, sorry, which the Alliance shared. Ian from the Alliance shared. Now, we probably do a lot more than I can explain the idea of healthcare, of housing and health and support. What I would say is, yesterday I was at got a lecture from a Michael Brown, who is a professor at Yale University. Now, in Yale, or I think it was at the moment, they are doing research into how long-term homelessness can result in mental health issues. One of the things that Michael said was, I'll pause for a second just because I didn't actually remember what he said. One of the things he said was that human rights, citizenship is helping human rights younger ball. I think as I've seen today, we all must have agreed with that. We all support human rights, we all support citizenship. I think to support this motion, what I would say is, if you're going to put healthcare on the social map, you've got to do it for support that. Sorry, I'll round up at that point because I'm starting to see my humble wobble up. Support the motion and thank you.
Your turn. Thank you. And can I just ask, I think the noise is actually coming from the exhibitors next door, not in here, but if you can hear me next door, please be quiet and show courtesy to our speakers in the conference hall. And now I'm delighted to welcome Mary Black to speak in favour of the amendment, to move the amendment. Mary Black, who's the candidate in Paisley and Renfrewshire South.
Sorry, that's me getting excited and ahead of myself coming on early. But anyway, the last time that I spoke at conference, I argued that the SNP had an opportunity like never before to be the party that could earn the title as the party of social justice. I can't tell you how good it feels to be standing here knowing that every day we get closer to that general election, we are earning that title day by day. We can proudly say that we are the only party at the forefront of this election who would rather spend money on childcare, on healthcare, on education, rather than spend it on renewing nuclear weapons to sit on the Clyde and rust. We can proudly say that we are the only party at the forefront of this election that are genuinely committed to ending the inhumane and ineffective austerity agenda, the crusade of cuts that both the Conservatives and the Labour Party seem hell-bent on implementing. The thing that we can be proudest of, though, is that despite all of this austerity, the SNP have managed to maintain policies that care about people. Something like the abolition of tuition fees, free prescriptions, increased childcare, free personal care for the elderly. These policies are all milestones on our journey to becoming the party that stands up for all people and not just a privileged few. However, the next step on that journey is to ensure fair and decent working conditions for all people. For society to work, there has to be a recognition that every single person and every single job is something of value and is important to our society. For too long, there has been a culture of treating people as disposable commodities that can be easily dismissed at the drop of a hat. For too long, people and their skills, whatever they may be, have been undervalued and taken for granted by too many employers through the means of zero-hour contracts. No worker, no person should ever be made to feel as though they are inadequate. They should never be made to feel as though they are expendable. No person should have to feel as though they should be grateful for the odd hours that they may or may not receive. Just on Thursday there, David Cameron admitted himself that he could not survive on a 0 hours contract. So why then does he expect anyone else to survive? The greatest quality about all our policies has been that we implement dignity and respect to all people. That's the hallmark of free personal care for the elderly. we now have a responsibility to ensure that that same level of dignity and respect is felt by those providing the service as well as those receiving. It's for this reason that I would urge Conference to accept the amendment that those employed in the home care sector should not be employed on zero-hour contracts, but should be given the security of set hours. Thank you.
And Derek Hunter to second the amendment. And Derek's first time speaker at conference.
Good afternoon, conference. Sorry about the delay in coming up, but there was someone a wee bit more important that had to speak. But I was enjoying that, even though my legs were getting a bit sore at the side there. I've been a member for a few years, but this is my first time speaking at conference. Indeed, it's actually my first conference. But Derek does say it's always like this, so I believe him. Many thanks to Mary Black for proposing the amendment to Resolution 7 for home care sector. As a Paisley and Renfrewshire South resident, I look forward to her ousting Mr. Douglas Alexander on the 7th of May. And as she will then become my local MP, and you can rest assured she has my vote. Now, I feel strongly that the conference should support this resolution and this amendment. My mother is in her 70s, although she'll probably kill me for letting you know that. But she has various health issues, which on different days of the week she tells me what's hurting. But I want her in years to come to be able to retain a quality of life within the community and within her own home, as long as she physically can. I want my brother, who has a rare kidney disease, to help get help in years to come without the need for hospitalisation. But I also want my sister-in-law, who is actually a care worker, to get a living wage, to continue to get a living wage, with a set minimum hours, which allows her to support her critically ill husband, my brother, and their two wonderful children. She is fortunate to be working for a reputable company on a full-time contract, but she has told me of others that she knows within the care sector who are forced by the DWP to take zero-hour contracts, as that's all that they can find. And she's given me a bit of an insight into what life is actually like for someone in that care sector on a zero-hour contract. The questions were, can they get a mortgage or any other credit? The answer is no, they can't. Can they claim tax credits? No, they can't. If they don't have enough hours that week to live on, can they claim benefits to top that up? No, they can't. Do they get holidays, sick pay, or other employee benefits? You guessed it, no, they can't. One question to conference is that fair? The answer is the same. No, it is not fair. I take great pleasure in seconding this amendment to Resolution 7 on home care sector by adding the following. They should not be employed on zero-hour contracts, but should be given the security of set hours. I urge conference to support this resolution and its amendment and give those working in the care sector the same dignity that they strive to give those in their care. Thank you very much.
It's working the live stream.
Okay, thank you. I don't have time to call any further speakers. Is Carol here to say she'll accept the amendment? Yeah, that's okay. So, running out of time for summing up, can I ask conference, do you accept the amendment by acclaim? And thank you for that. And therefore, do you support the resolution as amended by acclaim? Thank you very much. We now turn to Resolution 8 on unconventional gas extraction, to be moved by Councillor Stephen Carleshi and seconded by Stephen Bird. Welcome, Stephen.
Thanks for
Thanks very much, Conference. Delegates, I'm delighted to move this motion today. I first got involved in unconventional gas campaign when an Australian company, Dart Energy, submitted an application for coalbed methane extraction in my ward in September 2012. As you can imagine, I was quickly contacted by many constituents who had concerns regarding this. An action group was quickly formed concerning communities of Falkirk who did extensive research on unconventional gas extraction and held various public meetings locally. They made links with other groups across Scotland who similarly had been formed to challenge developments in their area. They also came at my invitation to our conference 2 years ago at Perth and were warmly received and held an excellent fringe event which was well attended. These individuals put a considerable amount of their own time into this campaign, up against, as you can imagine, big international companies that simply sought to push this through under the radar, assisted by the UK government's weak regulatory regime. Conference, let's thank all the hard work of all these campaign groups and everyone who has organised and attended marches, protests and public meetings across our country. Thank you, Conference. I'm sure that would be much appreciated. The fracking company, Dart Energy, came to the UK as they had just been forced to pull out production in their own home country after extensive research was conducted for the New South Wales Parliament found that unconventional gas extraction to cause environmental and health effects to local communities. To counter this, their Parliament had introduced a 2 kilometre buffer zone which had effectively stopped the industry in New South Wales. Now, they didn't come to that conclusion overnight. They, like our government, initiated a detailed assessment of the effects of this industry to local communities. A key contributor to their assessment, Dr. Marion Lloyd-Smith, a senior advisor to the National Toxics Network in Australia, reported when she came to speak to the Scottish Parliament 2 years ago, even if companies follow the best regulation, it just isn't simply possible to rule out damaging effects of unconventional gas extraction on public health and the environment. She went on to say, in Australia, where the industry had been operating for some years, we are already seeing evidence of communities suffering the health impacts associated with the industry's pollution. Also, concerns for pollution to our rivers are showing environmental damage. Farmers are losing access to clean water, and rural communities are being industrialised and losing their way of life. Earlier this week, I took our parliamentary candidate, John McNally, and in 40 days, the next MP for Falkirk, to meet one of the... Thank you. I'm sure he'll appreciate that. I'm very sure he will. To meet one of the farmers in my ward who has led the campaign of local farmers against this development. We went to see his land where there had been past wells drilled and where companies hoped to frack as new licences have been issued by the UK government. He was very clear in outlining the damage he believed that was caused to his land by previous test wells that were drilled over 20 years ago. There's been much talk of the financial benefits of this industry to local communities. Recently, a small community wind farm has been set up in my area, which will for 25 years provide a fund to support local organisations. The current coalbed methane development proposed, which will generate huge profits to the companies involved, offers no financial contribution, no identified employment opportunities for local community, and critically, no bond to secure against the cost of cleaning up the site after the development has ceased. Conference, Scotland is a net exporter of gas. It has a wealth of renewable energy supplies. Scotland doesn't need this gas, and it's becoming clear that Scotland doesn't want this gas. I submitted a formal objection to the application. I'd hope my ward colleagues in the Labour Party that have been rather quiet about it would do likewise. The Scottish Government then took the right decision in announcing there would be a public inquiry on the application, which would give the local community the chance to have their voice heard. My evidence that I gave at that public inquiry raised the concerns that residents had raised with me. Of course, Dart Energy, the applicant, were not concerned with any of this at all. I got agreement from my council group to sign up to Concerned Communities of Falkirk's excellent community charter they'd drawn up. Many of the charter's aspirations were those we'd argued for during the referendum for a fairer, cleaner and sustainable Scotland. However, when it came to voting for it at Falkirk Council, every single Labour and Tory member voted against it.
Stephen, time's up.
Thanks very much. Just got a few things to wind up with. Thanks, Derek.
No, winding up. That's you. 5 minutes,
I'm
afraid.
Is that
me? Yep.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, Stephen. Sorry to do that, but it had to happen. To second Stephen Bird, to be followed by John Smart, who will move the remit back. Stephen.
Thank you, Conference. In the Gettysburg Address, Abraham Lincoln said that it was a battle to ensure that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. Today, our government, our SNP government, is involved in a battle to make sure that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall safeguard the earth. It's a fundamental bedrock of democracy that informed consent of the people is required for government to function. It's one of the reasons why we see the coalition is collapsing roundabout, is because they neither inform nor they gain consent. And it doesn't matter whether that's trying to look at developments in Scotland or whether it's trying to look at developments across the Weald in the south of England, where they're proposing to go fracking right across the continent of the Tory Shires of England. They don't care what the people actually think. And the difference between the SNP and the London parties is summed up very, very clearly in that simple difference. This government is taking the simple steps to make sure that whatever decision is taken, it's taken on the basis of evidence. It's taken on facts. It's not taken on assertions. It's taken in the interests of all the people of Scotland. It's not taken just in the interest of the energy companies of Scotland. And it's one of those strange coincidences that you sometimes get. You think back to the first resolution, the first topical we had this afternoon, and the threats that are being posed by to Longannet. And one of the things that when the Dart Energy submitted their application, they told us how they were going to manufacture electricity from the gas off Letham Moss in Stephen and I's ward. And just think what the future holds now for Longannet. What we know now is that the coal bed methane extraction, which they told us couldn't be done, it technically wasn't possible, the seams wouldn't take it. What we know now is that that was nothing more and nothing less than a pack of lies. If there was any morality whatsoever in the Dart Energy application, rather than waiting for the moratorium to be over and the reporter to come forward with a judgment, Dart Energy would simply come forward and say, "We told you, porkies, it's not about coal bed methane extraction, it's actually about fracking," and they know by their own admission that that is an entirely different issue. Conference, please support the resolution.
Thank you, Stephen. And now John Smart to move the remit back, but I will require to make it competent a seconder to the remit back if there is one. I don't see a seconder, which means...
There's a guy over there.
Yeah. Yeah, there is a seconder, formal seconder. So John, to move the remit back. 3 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I agree with the previous speaker that we should make an informed choice. But some of the opposition to fracking is totally unreasonable. We're told about an earthquake which was caused near Blackpool by fracking. That just isn't true. There was a tremble of teacups which was two orders of magnitude less than the kind of thing that we get regularly every year at Cymru. That objection is about as valid as a £9 note. There are genuine difficulties to be overcome and genuine considerations.
My mic is not on. You need to go and speak just a bit closer to the microphone, okay?
Oh, sorry. Can you hear me now? The Royal Society, the Royal Society of Engineering, and the Scottish Government's expert advisory panel on the subject all voted that fracking was capable of being done properly and was necessary. We've now got a moratorium which will allow reasoned discussion based on evidence. The previous speaker also advocated discussion based on evidence, but we shouldn't assume the result before the discussion. A committee of the Scottish Parliament just the other day announced that they were going to hold a full-scale consultation into the whole field of energy, and they've invited individuals, organisations, parties, anybody that wants to submit evidence. We should let these discussions take place and then arrive at a reasoned conclusion. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, John. Thank you, John. Again, the party leader spoke for longer than I expected, so I'm really short of time, so I can't call any other speakers. And I assume that John and Stephen will waive their right to sum up and I can go straight to the vote. Is that okay, John and Stephen as well? I can't see you. If you can just confirm you waive your right to sum up. Yep, okay. Now we'll go to the vote then, delegates. So voting cards at the ready. And again, for newer members, I should explain. Remit back essentially means that the policy is not approved and the party reconsiders it at some point in the future, and then we vote for the resolution. So I'll call a vote on the remit back and then the resolution. So those in favour of the remit back, please show. Not really, it's a point of order. Cards down. I can't really debate it with you now, but those against the remit back, please show. Cards down, the remit back is clearly defeated, so those in favour of the resolution, please show. Cards down, those against the resolution, please show. Okay, the resolution is overwhelmingly carried, and I'm happy to speak to you later, okay? Thanks very much. And we now turn to Resolution 9 on land reform, to be moved by Ian Muirhead and seconded by Tom Gray.
The motion before you today is a modest proposal, which, if enacted, will enable meaningful land reform. I haven't come here today to argue for any vast departure from party policy, but merely to reaffirm our desire to uphold our historic and continuing commitment to land reform. One of the forces for change which helped to forge this party was the desire of restless generations of Scots to make Scotland a land of opportunity. Land reform is essential if we want to make that land of opportunity a reality. But how could land reform best be summed up and understood by the general public? The answer is one word, and that word is empowerment. One of the common themes in the relationship between Scotland's land and her people has been one of disempowerment, which has had far-reaching social and economic consequences. No one ever said land reform would be easy. But the results of empowerment are positive, and the evidence can be found in successful nations such as Norway and Denmark. These countries have demonstrated the benefits of a diverse, decentralised, property-owning democracy. One of the ways we can achieve widespread land ownership is by granting heritable agricultural tenants the right to buy their holdings and therefore giving them legal parity with their crofting counterparts. This would mean that 25% of agricultural land in Scotland, currently owned by a handful of estates, could be purchased by the thousands of tenant farming families who live, work and call that land home. Such a right was granted across Europe decades and indeed centuries ago. To put it into perspective, it was even proposed by the Conservative Party at their 1946 conference. The consequences of widespread land ownership are surprising. It has led to more opportunities for young farmers and new entrants, thus helping to boost rural economies, maintain local services, and bolster domestic food production. Indeed, nearly all European nations with diverse land ownership have much larger tenanted sectors. The difference is that unlike in Scotland, where most tenant farmers rent the whole farm, including the family home, in European nations, the vast majority of tenant farmers are also owner-occupiers. In other words, tenants and lairds have equal status. By enacting such a measure, we can make our country fairer whilst also boosting our economy. It's wrong that our land ownership structure should still largely be the product of feudal land grabs. And more importantly, it puts us at an economic disadvantage to our European cousins. It can't be right that folk of modest means have to pay so much for a basic plot of land on which to build a home, a direct consequence of our distorted land market and an impediment to our economic well-being. We have a golden opportunity to give people hope. I'm sure many of you, like me, will have personal stories of brothers or sisters, cousins or uncles, who've had to look for opportunities in nations far from these shores. It's heartbreaking that all too often, many of our brightest and best look for opportunity elsewhere. In conclusion, I believe in Dr. Aileen MacLeod, we have a champion of our cause, summed up by an old saying brought into the 21st century, cometh the hour, cometh the woman. Aileen, if you're listening, which I hope you are, the future hopes and aspirations of a generation are in your hands. All I would ask is that you carry them with care, and let's endeavour to make Scotland a land of opportunity. Thank you for listening.
And Tom Gray to second the resolution, to be followed by Councillor Richard Laird to move the amendment. Tom.
Now for the practical implications. Conference. 70 tenanted family farms lost since World War II within the three parishes of Meath, Obraco and Blackford, covering half the Strathallan ward in southern Perthshire. I ask you, is this acceptable? 30 family opportunities lost from one estate alone. Only 5 tenant families remain while the land of the other 30 is farmed by the estate itself. Ever since security of tenure was enacted in 1948, many states have systematically taken back tenanted farms into their own hands. And of course, gathered subsidies originally designed to maintain rural communities and support food production on family farms. This is a common situation throughout Scotland. Tenants move on, retire or die, offspring are discouraged to commit to the poor housing and working conditions. The tenancy is lost, and with it, another farming opportunity is gone. Clearly, the only possibility of tenanted farms remaining as family farms is as if they are sold to the families on them. For remaining tenants, there are some truly desperate circumstances in remote areas, leaving tenants in isolation and dire need of change. On such farms, lack of capital investment by landowners means that tenants are invariably the sole investors on the farms. Farmhouses, if still habitable, are invariably below tolerable standard. As borrowing so heavily, too heavily invest in property which you do not own is simply not possible, owner occupation is the only solution whereby required farmhouse and infrastructure improvements can be made. The irony is, this country sold the best of its council houses built and maintained by public funds and did not replace them. Yet families who have been sole investors doing patch-up jobs in the fabric of their homes and farms are denied opportunity to own theirs and thereby make the serious and necessary improvements to them. Such farms are ultimately lost. So what are we left with in those areas where tenant farms have gone? We have estates running the farms scattered throughout their areas as they have become available to them. We no longer have settled working rural community, but very often empty houses and steadings, often finally sold to non-farming interest. The land becomes detached from the residents living within it. Now compare to those owner-occupied farms where investment is made as the farm requires. In the countryside, there is often a clear, visible distinction between an owner-occupied farm and a tenanted farm. Serious investment and lack of it are the obvious indicators. Now think the human factor. Cast a thought on the minds and frustration of those trapped in houses and workplace they cannot improve to the standard they would wish, yet have poured blood, sweat and tears into them over successive generations. Our countryside needs these people, but not their home and livelihood conditions. Our rural communities and services need these people. Our farming industry has a poor record of safeguarding the contribution of individual farming families in the maintenance of our countryside and their contribution to rural life. Yet that same industry is now desperately seeking new opportunities in farming. I suggest we start today and stop getting rid of them. Support the motion.
Thank you. Thank you, Tom and Councillor Richard Laird, to move the amendment. So we're going to have a wee change. Helpful when I get the card in time, but I know you passed it in. Even better than that, Drew Henry, your constituency is again
Inverness, Nairn, Badenoch and Strathspey. And there is no better example of where land reform could accelerate local democracy than in Inverness, Nairn, Badenoch and Strathspey. Beautiful rural land sits side by side with urban development. For example, in places like Aviemore. You know Aviemore, it's the place Danny Alexander goes for his holidays. On the main road lies a pile of rubble, left empty as the original promise of a Tesco superstore was. People have for too long been locked out of its development, an important part of their own future. Conference, people in these exciting times are energized and just won't accept corporations giving themselves bonuses for banking land anymore. As a key player on the Commission for Strengthening Local Democracy, I've listened to people telling us to give them the tools so that they can do the job in a way that works for them and their vision. The SNP is determined to deliver that. That's what drives our commitment to ensure that power lies in the hands of local people. The others haven't even started to catch up. Contrast this with the washed-out promises of the Smith Commission, like the return of the Crown Estate assets, being eroded like sandcastles on Nairn Beach. The other parties are out of touch, and now they're out of time. They're going to have to deal with a strong group of SNP MPs at Westminster. Our communities want to grow, but not at the expense of leaving people behind. They're drawn to our principles of inclusive growth. They're rejecting the Tory austerity dogma propped up by the Lib Dems and supported by Labour. Instead, they're saying to us that the future should be built on the ambitions and needs of the shoulders of our communities, not on the backs of the poor. So the Land Reform Bill itself moves this nation forward. It's a huge step in realising local democracy, And coupled with the Community Empowerment Bill, we have what is possibly the greatest advance in empowering communities that modern Scotland has seen. Friends, these ambitions are at the soul of our communities in both rural and urban areas. People want this power. Please support this amendment.
Thank you. Thank you, Drew. And Richard Laird to second. And Richard, I'm really struggling for time. Do you think you can do this in 2 minutes? Great. And can also ask for the approval from conference to extend the session by 15 minutes so I can take the final resolution. Thank you. Richard.
Thank you, conference convener. I'll forgive your confusion because I realise it is unusual to find a Laird who supports land reform. Most of the previous speakers have talked about the benefits of land reform to our rural communities, but I'd like to take the few moments I have to talk about the potential it preserves for our urban areas, because the relevance of land reform does not stop where the streetlights begin. For example, the link between urban regeneration and land reform is indisputable. Towns and cities across the country have prime redevelopment sites which lie empty, which lie vacant, which lie unoccupied, which lie underused. The reasons they lie like this is because their owners are content for them to be that way. The Land Reform Review Group, in its report, among its many recommendations, proposed that local authorities should have the power to introduce compulsory sales orders. So councils could say to these landowners, if you are not willing to put these sites to good use, then you should sell it to somebody who is. Similarly, it's impossible to separate the issue of housing out of this debate because you cannot separate the building of homes from the land upon which they sit. And many of our communities who face the greatest housing need are brought about by the problem of land banking, where companies come along, buy up tracts of land, see that land allocated for housing, but rather than building homes, are content to rise in value and to improve their balance sheets. Proposals like the Housing Land Corporation proposal like the Housing Land Corporation will go some way towards dealing with that, and in the process helping the 8,500 households we have on our housing wait list in the Highlands and many thousands of others across the country. Conference, land reform is about croft and it's about shops. It's about sporting estates, but it's also about housing estates. It's relevant to us all whether we live in urban or rural communities, and that's why I'm happy to second this amendment and ask you to support both it and the motion.
Thank you, Richard. And Tom and Ian, can I have the agreement of Ian? Do you accept the amendment? Yes, you do. And do you both waive your right to sum up? Yes, you do. Can I ask conference, is the amendment accepted by acclaim? And as amended, is the resolution passed by acclaim? It is. Thank you very much. Now we turn to Resolution 10, Access to Election, and it will be moved by Grant Toms and seconded by Dennis Robertson, MSP. Welcome back, Grant. Now, can I also say, because of time, if all speeches can be kept to 2 minutes or less?
90 seconds in our case. Conference, I hope that this actually is a very straightforward motion to be supported. It's not rocket science. Essentially, in my role as convener of candidate assessment panel, looking at all our candidates that come for our potential, our members who come forward as potential candidates for local and parliament, we recognise that there are obstacles if you have disabilities, some of them seen, some of them unseen, but they nevertheless stand in the way for many people coming forward to stand for elected office. What the UK government did over the last 2 or 3 years is actually have a fund which was applicable for individuals to basically support them through candidate assessment, candidate selection, and in standing for election to various forms of government, of which only the UK government elections are permissible for Scottish people to apply for. They deliberately restricted that to English local government, parish councils, etc., but not for European elections and not for Scottish Parliament or councils. This is an opportunity to basically correct that and ask the Scottish Government to explore this for to remove this barrier, create the funds available, and put us on a par with the rest of the UK on that. If not, move forward by maybe extending it to other groups who face similar types of barriers. And you'll hear more from people who've had that experience of trying to stand for election. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Grant. Thank you, Grant. I now call Dennis Robertson, MSP, to speak, to be followed by Carol Wood, who will move the amendment. Dennis Robertson.
Good afternoon, conference, and thank you, Derek. I'll ignore the red light if you don't mind. And I say that in all seriousness, because the reason I do say these things is because it's to draw your attention to the fact that, you know, disability can be an individual thing. And when we come to sort of looking at parliamentary candidates or those going forward to local authority, yes, we do have different needs. Yes, we do require different support. I require the support of my family, my branch, my constituency, and the party, because otherwise I certainly wouldn't be where I am today. An MSP for Aberdeenshire West, a constituency that the Lib Dems held for many, many years, but one which we are going to continue to hold for many, many more. Now, but I say the conference in seriousness. You know, Grant's saying there's a discriminatory factor here in the support, and because of some financial support. And there is indeed to all candidates that go out there knocking doors and everything else. True. But as you probably gathered, I mean, I didn't come on the stage by myself. I've got him. But believe me, he would have rather gone to see Derek than to bring me to the platform here. So I had Francis with me. And this is the sort of thing that, you know, every person with a disability may require when we're out and about, either knocking doors or doing street work or becoming, and actually trying to get our branches, our constituencies, and yes, the party to accept that a person with a disability can indeed become a candidate, can indeed become a councillor, can indeed become an MSP MP. We've got a party, I believe, that believes in equality, and that equality should not just be based on gender selection. It shouldn't be based on disability selection. It should be based on competency. And I think if a person comes before you with a disability, please don't recognise them as a disabled person. Recognise them as a person with ability and competence who has a disability. And that is a reason why we ask you to support this motion, because there is a discriminatory factor at the moment. It's okay for, it's happening in England, but not in Scotland. That's a discriminatory process. We need to stop it. We need to stop it now. Thank you, conference.
Thanks, Dennis. Thank you, Dennis. And now, Carol Wood to move the amendment, and I require a formal seconder to the amendment. Yeah, thank you. So Carol Wood, who is also a first-time speaker at conference.
Hi. Conference, I'm a disabled person, and I actually did try to stand for election in another part of the UK and use the access to elected office fund, which is what we're actually talking about. It enabled me to have a great deal of confidence in people around me who supported me and enabled me to stand for election in a local council. Didn't get it, but we doubled the vote, so we were good to go. However, that notwithstanding, I couldn't have done it without the extra funding that was available for me for transport costs, for extra carer hours, and for the support of the constituency members of the party that I was standing for. The thing is that doesn't happen for Holyrood elections, and I think that's really, really unfair. Disabled people in Scotland have a voice. We want that voice to be heard. We want to represent you. We want to be viable members of the community. We are viable members of the community, but we want to show you that. We want to be We want to be part, we want to be seen as part of the community, not an add-on. We don't want identical treatment because we can't have that. We have disabilities that prevent that. However, we want to be equal members and equal participants in our society. And we'd like to ask the Scottish Government to look at this this resolution really carefully and to actually put some money forward so that people with disabilities, people with mental health issues, people with specific learning difficulties can actually make a contribution to the vibrant Scottish political scene that we've got at the moment and to be seen to be member, contributing members of the, our society. So I'd like you to accept the amendment and the resolution. Thank you very much.
Thanks, conference. The next speaker will be Jamie Simkowiak from Forth to speak in favour of the resolution.
Good afternoon, conference. My name is Jamie Simkowiak and I'm the founder of the One in Five campaign, a campaign to encourage, empower and increase political participation amongst disabled people in Scotland. Scotland has witnessed Thank you. Scotland has witnessed an incredible upsurge in political enthusiasm over recent years, with equality being a shared desire, regardless of which way a person votes or which political party they support. As one in five people of working age in Scotland is disabled, we aspire to have political representation and participation that reflects our society. This long-term aspiration is ambitious. It will take time and effort, but we believe that if, as a first step, political parties and organisations ensure meetings and materials are accessible at local and national levels, our aspiration is achievable. Friends, I only became politically active this time last year and joined the SNP last August. I came up with the idea for the One in Five campaign on Sunday, the 15th of February this year. And with my newly found political confidence, I went straight to the top and emailed our party leader, our First Minister, the very next morning. Within 2 hours, I received a reply advising our Equalities and Women's Officer, Tasmina Ahmed Sheikh, would be in touch later that day, where a meeting was arranged a few weeks later. That's incredible. That's been a member of the SNP. Conference, I'm delighted to announce today that within the last 3 weeks, all six major political parties who have represented us in the Scottish Parliament have signed up to the One in Five Charter. Given time constraints, you can check that on our website, oneinfive.scot. Now, friends, the next bit is interactive, so I ask that you get out your smartphones and open up your social media. As not only do I ask that you support this resolution, but I also ask that you give your support to the One in Five campaign. Invite us to speak about disability-related issues and follow in the footsteps of Leith Walk SNP, Dunoon SNP and Rutherglen SNP by signing up your local branch to make sure this campaign has an impact at the grassroots. I would like to invite you with the support of Christina McKelvey to our official launch outside Parliament this Tuesday at 1 p.m. Lastly, for those here today and watching at home, I would like you to join our campaign on Facebook, which is One in Five campaign, and the interactive part, if you've got your Twitter accounts open. In terms of funding, it's all done by ourselves, so social media is where it's at for us. I would like you to tweet, I support, at One in Five Scott, all lowercase, all words, not the numbers, so One in Five Scott, hashtag disabilities and politics. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamie. Interactive politics conference, you can't beat it. Carol, are you waiving your right to sum up?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And Grant, also? Yep. Thank you very much. That takes us to the vote on this. We'll vote on the amendment, first of all. Is the amendment accepted by acclaim? Thank you very much, and therefore the amended resolution by acclaim. Sorry. Okay, the National Secretary will now make a couple of announcements.
Thank you, Conference. Just before we close the session, a couple of announcements. There's a social event this evening to adopt Alison Thewlis as the candidate for Glasgow Central. It takes part in the Kinning Park complex next to the Kinning Park Underground from 6:30. Nicola Sturgeon and Sandra White will both be speaking at that event, so members are encouraged to go along if they don't have other plans. I know there are a few social events taking place. I've also been asked to remind everyone that the clocks go forward this evening, so bear that in mind if you're planning to come to conference first thing tomorrow. As we clear the hall, can we remember, please, to take everything with us, bags, jackets, so that the hall is completely clear. Thanks very much, and we'll see everyone bright and early tomorrow morning.
Thanks very much.